So I'm Alexey Stukalov. I work at Center of Molecular Medicine in Vienna, and I would like to introduce you our recent development for the method of deconvolution of targeted protein-protein interaction maps from affinity purification data. So protein-protein interaction networks is the very common concept in bioinformatics, but what these protein-protein interaction networks doesn't capture is the fact that proteins are assembled into complexes, and the complexes are actually the machinery that carry out all functions within the cell. And knowing this machinery is very important, and also to understand the function of particular protein, and also to model and predict things from the data. There are many methods that try to predict these protein complexes from the public interaction databases that aggregate many experimental data sets obtained with heterogeneous experimental techniques and use different filtering thresholds for these interactions. And what we wanted to do instead, we wanted to be able to predict complexes from the raw data of one particular experimental technique, namely the affinity purification coupled with mass spectrometry. And moreover, we wanted to be able to predict complexes from focused studies where we are investigating the interactors of the proteins involved in a particular pathway or of a particular biological function or a family of related proteins. And in this, also in we wanted to be able to process the data set where you cannot actually integrate the prior knowledge of protein complexes, for example, because it's a unique biological system. And for example, the system with lots of genetic aberrations, and then whatever complexes you would find there, you would not find in normal system. The problem with these data sets is that there are just very few actually APMS data sets done on the genome wild scale when you can use this concept of protein complex as a dense subgraph in the interaction networks. And these genome scale data sets were done in simple organisms like yeast. Whereas in these focused studies, they are done in mammalian cells. Doing them in mammalian cells is much more difficult, and usually you have only a few dozen of baits. And then when you have the output from the experiment in this sort of a network, where these blue points are those proteins that you identify, and these blue points are connected only to the red ones, and they are not interconnected with each other, and then they can constitute up to 95% of the proteins that you identify in the data set. And this concept doesn't work in this type of networks, and you need to come up with some other solution. That's what we wanted to do. So just a little bit of introduction of the of this experimental technique. So you are interested in the interactors of the protein that you call bait. You genetically modify this protein, introduce a short tag sequence. So this protein, still modified protein, still can fold normally and can participate in all normal interactions as its native form. But in addition, it can also bind to the magnetic beads using this tag sequence. And you can use that to actually purify from the sample all protein complexes that contain the bait protein. Then this purified sample is submitted to the normal mass spectrometry pipeline. So first you digest this protein into peptides so that you can then analyze by mass spectrometer. You submit these peptides to the mass spectrometer, collect the peptide spectra, then you match this peptide spectra with the theoretical peptide spectra from the protein database, and therefore you reconstruct the protein content of the sample. What's more important, that the more abundant is the protein in the sample, the more spectra would be collected by the mass spectrometer of this particular protein. And you can use this number, the spectral counts, as sort of a very approximate semi-quantitative measure of protein abundance. And although it's imprecise, it was very useful in many studies, for example, this one, to estimate some preliminary abundance of a protein. So once again, what you have for your protein of interest, the bait, you identify the its interactors, so the proteins that are physically associated with the bait protein in the complexes. But there is no way that you can tell how many, from one single experiment, how many protein complexes are there, and you cannot deconvolute proteins of one complex from another. You need to have more experiments. Still, we wanted that the number of experiments, the number of different baits that you would use in your data set is minimal. And that's, that was the idea of our method, which we call BMAP. It was published in JPR in 2012. BMAP stands for Bayesian inference of protein modules a posteriori. So our idea is that in this structural assembly of protein complexes, between the level of individual proteins and protein complexes, there is sort of intermediate level of protein complex modules. So these protein complex modules are a group of proteins that could be shared among different complexes. And the proteins inside these modules are very tightly connected with each other. Therefore, whenever you pull down protein complexes using whatever bait you have, all you will retrieve all components of one module at once, and the abundance of these components would be the same, whatever bait you use. So translating this to a mathematical definition of the model, suppose you have this matrix, which is the outcome of APMS experiment. So the columns are the bait proteins that you use, and the rows are all the proteins that you identified in this set of experiments. Then in the cells of the matrix, you have the number of spectral counts for a particular protein in a particular experiment. So our assumptions mean that you can group the columns and you can group the rows such that these groups would correspond to protein complex modules. And this grouping would induce this block structure of the matrix. And inside the block, the abundance of all the proteins in all experiments would be the same. So this kind of B clustering is called chessboard B clustering. And what's nice, by taking into account this abundance of the proteins, we are able to overcome the limitation of the connectivity in the network that we are able to obtain from the experimental data set. And what is also nice about this model that we are going to use is that it has an equivalent representation as a network. So in this network, the nodes correspond to the groups of proteins that you have in this B clustering, and the edges corresponds to actually the B clusters. So we sort of aggregate multiple bait protein interactions into one single interaction. And first of all, that simplifies the network, simplifies its representation, and then it makes it more confident and the quantitation more reliable. So As I said, we're dealing with the quite fuzzy data, the spectral counts, and also we want to deal with the situations where the data is limited. Therefore, we decided not to do a naive approach when we try to come up with one single best model. Instead, we wanted to do it in a statistical, in a Bayesian way, and explore the whole space of possibilities and define a statistical distribution of all possible models. So our prior model is quite simple. So we use Pitman-Yor process to define the prior probabilities for this row and column clusters, and we use normal scale inverse gamma distribution as a prior for these cluster abundances. And then what is more interesting is the likelihood component of this model. So because of the dual nature of these APMS datasets, it's quantitative and it's also sort of structural, topological. This likelihood consists of several components. First, the quantitative component that tries to feed this abundance of big clusters with the spectral counts of individual proteins that are actually observed. And we use Lagrangian Poisson distribution, which allows us to model this spectral counts. And also there is a topological component, and we use hypergeometric distribution there. And it accounts for the fact that proteins that are seen with the same baits, they are likely to belong to the same protein complex modules. And also protein complex modules should be different from each other. And that we sort of enforce the topological structure that we have because we are dealing with protein complexes. We enforce this structure in our data set. And also there is experimental design component because these bait proteins that we use in the experiments, they are also identified as prey, and there should be consistency between bait and prey clusters. So we use the normal approach, so we construct Markov chain Monte Carlo model for inferring this probabilistic distribution, and we have a number of Gibbs steps, like sampling the abundance, randomly sampling the abundance of this big cluster, or switching it from on to off state. Also a number of steps that shuffle columns and rows between different clusters. And of course, you need to do it properly to maintain the balance equation and make the Monte Carlo Markov chain correct and stationary. The problem here is that we are dealing with quite large data sets, and it's not enough to have this Markov chain Monte Carlo to efficiently explore the whole space of parameters. Therefore, we used this equi-energy sampler to more efficiently explore the space. It's sort of parallel tempering technique. First of all, it allows us to explore the space more efficiently, and also it allows us to do the computations because they are very intensive in parallel across different CPUs. That's sort of a result, the probabilistic landscape. Here, every dot in this diagram, and we collect about 5,000 putative models from the run of our Markov chain Monte Carlo. So every dot here represents one possible solution for a particular data set. Now for the actual applications of this method, so we applied it to this nice data sets of chromatin remodeling complexes, which was done in the lab of Michael Washburn. So it was sort of positive control data set because we were able to recapitulate with our results what they did by hierarchical clustering and manual annotation of the complexes. But actually we did more than that because we actually applied our algorithm to a set that included also proteins that they classified as non-specific binders. And within this set of non-specific binders, we were actually able to identify two additional complexes, a part of the spliceosome and T. Sheparanin protein complex. And then Michael Washburn actually confirmed that we are right. These protein complexes do actually bind to these chromatin remodeling complexes as well. And identifying these just using hierarchical clustering would not be possible because the patterns of these ones are much more subtle than the other modules in this data set. Then we applied it to a much more complicated data set, the autophagy interaction network that included around 70 baits and around 2,000 proteins identified. And this is actually the case where the number of baits is rather limited to efficiently deconvolute protein complexes of that we have in the data set. And here is actually where our Bayesian statistical approach can help us, because then we can consider every putative protein modules that we identified, and here every dot is one putative protein complex that we sampled. And then we can ask how many times in this collection of samples, in the collection of models that we calculated, how many times it's encountered as it is or as a part of a bigger module. And that gives us what we call the fraction of the samples we observe. This module gives us what we call the stability index. And as you see in this chromatin remodeling data set, the stability is much higher than in this autophagy data set. But then what we can do, we can filter for the stability and we can retain only the most stable module candidates. And that is what we did. So these are the stable modules that we have from the autophagy dataset. What is interesting that they encompass around 400 proteins, and 300 of these proteins were not considered as a part of a high-confidence network of the original study, but yet we find many examples of known protein complexes or modules among this list. And also when we are looking at the Go annotation, we obtain a nice separation of the Go terms between protein models. So it suggests that we can also predict the functions of the unknown proteins by extrapolating Go terms of the known ones. And so on. We did also a confirmation by looking at the domain contacts. So we use this 3DID database of domain contacts, and we mapped it into our putative protein modules. And indeed, we observed the enrichment of the number of the domain contacts per protein when we compare it to some random sets of proteins from these data sets, or to the predictions of the alternative methods. And of course, as the size of the protein modules grows and becomes less sensitive, so it's not likely that real protein modules would be of this big size, the rate of predictions become lower. Yet we wanted actually to understand how well we can identify what we call protein complex modules. But because so far we know very little about protein complexes, there is no golden standard data sets where we can say we know all the protein complexes in this data set. Therefore, we decided to do comprehensive synthetic modeling. So we developed a synthetic model of protein complexes, and then the model, we can simulate the affinity purification of these complexes and then model the mass spectrometry outcome of this purification. And then we were able, dependent on how you define protein complex modules, we can identify from in this synthetic data set these protein complex modules or subcomplexes as is proposed by an alternative method. And then we generated 100 synthetic data sets and were asking how well we can recover these protein complex modules. And these are the results. So we checked how often the pairs of the proteins that should belong to the same protein complex would actually be predicted to belong to the same cluster, and how frequently the pairs of proteins that are belonging to different complexes would indeed be identified as belonging to different modules. And as you can see, we're doing quite good. Also, you need to adjust this result sort of by chance, and even if you adjust it with respect to this, we are still better than the alternative method. So this is a nested cluster which is developed in the Nisvirsky lab. So I've come to the conclusion. So there is a paper when you can read about the method. Also, there is a very detailed supplementary material that explains all the math behind it. You can get the source code. It's written in C++. It extensively uses the Boost library and MPI for these parallel imputations. I think it's a robust and competitive algorithm for detecting these protein complex modules. The immediate outcome for the biologist is that it significantly simplifies the interpretation of APMS datasets. And it's not only limited to the datasets when you use a protein to purify the sample, the protein complexes. You can also apply it to drug pull downs where you use drug as a bait and you retrieve protein complexes that bind to this drug. Also, you can apply it to DNA or RNA baits. And the future direction is, for example, to use more precise quantitative MS data, which could be extracted from these ion chromatograms, to integrate in this Bayesian model the prior knowledge using, for example, co-expression of proteins or Go annotations. And of course, you can extend the model to capture this protein complex dynamics to actually approach the problem of how these protein complex modules assemble into complexes. And I would like to acknowledge my group. So this is SEMBA Informatics Department. I would like to thank Jacques, who defined this problem and was supervising the project, and Florian Bright-Wieser, because he helped me a lot with technical things in dealing with the mass spectrometry data. I would like to thank a funding agency, which was provided by Genau project, and travel ship was generously provided by ISCB. Thank you.
There's this nice example of a protein which is either connecting clusters or part of different clusters without having the clusters connected. So how does BindMap see this in the data?
Yeah, so what you see here is sort of schematic representation of protein complexes, and they can share different proteins within each other. So complexes can share proteins. When we define protein complex modules in the BMAP, we assume that one protein can belong only to one specific protein complex modules, and then the modules could be shared between the complexes. At least in the context of the APMS datasets you are analyzing, you have to assume that there is no sharing of proteins by these modules.
Okay. The second question, how long does it take BindMap to analyze, for example, this famous TRP49 dataset, and what is the upper border of size that you can analyze?
So for TRP49, it's, to produce sensible results, because of course you can play with the parameters a lot, the number of samples and thinning and so on. So I think it takes on our cluster using 64 nodes about two hours to produce the results. And it could actually be made a little bit faster. I also tried to analyze this Marcotti-Emily data set, where they used like 1,000 purifications and identified, I don't know, 4,000, if I'm not mistaken, proteins. And it also could be analyzed. So you are a little bit running with troubles with memory, but still it's possible.
Excuse me?
Yes, with the normal PC, with the normal PC, you can analyze this TRP49 dataset. But for the bigger datasets, I think it would not be possible. Yes, in fact. So the question is that small proteomics group, they work with one tag that is used in the experiments. And the question is, does the algorithm help to identify those proteins that are specifically binding to the bait and are part of its complexes, or if these proteins are not specific, and if I understood it correctly?
Yes.
Yes, so in fact it helps. So as I showed with this TIP49 data set, the outcome was that it was able to nicely separate these non-specific binders from the specific ones. And then you know these scores like D-score, which was used in this autophagy paper, which accounts, which scores how probably it is that the interactor would be non-specific. And you can apply the same methodology to this modules that you identify. And in fact, we are currently investigating that. So this is what I'm researching currently. You actually enhance this filtering of non-specific binders when you use the results of the algorithm, because you can apply the algorithm to the unfiltered data set and then filter the results later. Excuse me, to which
data? To the string database where you have PKIs, protein-protein interaction. Because you would assume that proteins that have many connections with each other form a complex per se. So is there overlap with your analysis?
Yes. So for autophagy, I did this, and also because in these data sets you encounter a lot of proteins which are not very heavily investigated. We did this 3DID data set where you not look at a particular protein, but you look at its domains. So maybe you don't know the function of this particular protein, but you know that these domains tend to interact. And as I showed, there is some enrichment. And in cases where you know the protein, when there is some experimental data about these proteins, we can also show that there is enrichment of known interactions within the modules that we predict.